Good morning. It's good to welcome those of you here who are here in the room. It's good to welcome those of you who are joining us over the internet today. We are the Osceola United Methodist Church of Osceola, Wisconsin, and we welcome you to this Sunday morning service for February 13th. We have unanswerable questions, or at least we think of them as unanswerable. Maybe because the only one who really has a chance to answer them is God. But, well, you might have heard some of these questions. The first, or somebody say, maybe you've used this phrase yourself, the first thing I do when I get to heaven is I'm going to ask Jesus. And we think about, wouldn't it be nice just to have a chance even now to sit down, grab a cup of coffee with Jesus, and ask some of the tough questions, the unanswerable questions we seem to have. Questions like, well, what can I believe about heaven and hell? Or what's the point of church? Or can we trust the Bible, really? Well, we've been asking them this winter because we think it's important. We think that God really calls on us, wants us to wrestle with such questions. And that God may actually have given us a few hints to lead towards some understanding of them. So the question we're going to deal with today is one that comes from a place of grief and sorrow and pain. And that's essentially the question, where is God when it hurts? It's never academic when we ask this question. It's always personal. Why do we suffer? And it's not just those who are wicked that we know to be wicked or suffer, but good folks, innocent folks, and kids. So today we're going to talk about the problem of pain and suffering. I'm Jack Starr. I get to be pastor here at Osceola, and I want to welcome you to this worship service this morning. And I'm going to invite those who are in the room with us today to stand up. You can stand up at home as you, if you would like, and join us responsively in our call to worship. Holy Lord, everything we need is found in you. For those of us who come here feeling broken, for those of us who come here feeling weak, for those who come here weeping, bring joy. For those of us who come here with doubts, bring faith. For those who come here feeling shame, bring freedom. For those of us who come here feeling burdened, bring rest. For those of us who come here feeling anxious, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us join together in singing, I Know Whom I Have Believed. The words are up on the screen. Invite you at home. Sing along with us.
I know not why God's wondrous love to me he hath made. No unworthy Christ in love redeemed me as his own. But I know whom I have believed, and I'm persuaded that he is able. I've committed
seated.
We're going to look into the scripture, and as we do that, I would invite you to pray this prayer with me, a prayer for illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. So I want to look at two different scripture passages today, and we'll look into them a little bit. One of them is one that we've talked about recently, even last week. But let me start with something from the Old Testament. Psalm 13, just the first couple of verses. How long will you forget me, Lord? Forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long will I be left to my own wits, agony filling my heart daily? How long will my enemy keep defeating me? And let's turn now to the New Testament, to Romans 8, reading verses 18 through 28. I believe that the present suffering is nothing compared to the coming glory that's going to be revealed in us. The whole creation waits in anticipation for the revelation of God's sons and daughters. Creation was subject to frustration, not by its own choice. It was the choice of the one who subjected it. But in the hope that the creation itself will be set free from slavery to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of God's children. We know that the whole creation is groaning together and suffering labor pains up until now. And it's not only the creation, we ourselves, who have the Spirit as the first crop of the harvest, also groan inside as we wait to be adopted and for our bodies to be set free. We were saved in hope.
because he pleads for the saints consistent with God's will. We know that God works all things together for good, for the ones who love God, for those who are called according to his purpose. May God bless the hearing and the understanding of this portion of Scripture.
Thanks be to God.
We have a couple of friends who are going through some of the worst health conditions that we can imagine. We've all had some of our own struggles with health, but in our fellowship now, we know of some that we wait and we give calls to see how she's doing. We've just gotten word that one of our dear former pastors has had his cancer return. Tragedy and sorrow and grief, it can strike so suddenly. It can catch us as we're unaware. And this tragedy, it can happen to a large number of people or an individual. We're going about our everyday lives in a moment, and in the blink of an eye, the world can be changed. It seems like it was so recent, but this fall we passed the 20th anniversary of the terrorist attacks of 9/11. And then we remembered again what we were doing when we heard the news. And our nation has been living with that awful reality ever since. And much of the world has been living constantly with domestic terrorism for much longer than we have in North America. On that day, 20 years ago, 2,996 people died in New York, in Washington, and in Pennsylvania. Since those days, of course, thousands have died, and many of them in various tragedies. In 2004, an earthquake on the Pacific Ocean floor created a freak wave that became a tsunami that killed 250,000 people. On Friday, or as of this Friday, the World Health Organization says that, well, the number that I had, the official number was 5,783,776 people in the world who have died from COVID-19. So there are tragedies around us, large-scale tragedies that we sometimes, with broken hearts, say, why, God? But tragedy isn't always just out there. It comes and it touches us in our private lives. We've all experienced tragedy in some form. Most of the time, it isn't a big event, but whether it makes news or whether it happens in a quiet corner of the world, when you think of it, all tragedy is personal. You know, individuals lost loved ones at 9/11, in the tsunami. How many hundreds and thousands of stories about those who have lost loved ones from COVID. And there's a lot of other brokenness and grief and sorrow too. I mean, illness, abuse, broken relationships, betrayal, sorrow, loss, injury, disappointment, crime, heartache, and death. It's like life should come with a warning label, right? Actually, it kind of does. You know, Jesus is the one that said, in this world, you will have trouble. I mean, he laid it right out there. But at any rate, when it occurs, our first nature, our first impulse is to ask some questions. Why? Why is there suffering and pain? Why? All of this, if there's a loving and powerful God, why do bad things happen to good people? We've been looking at questions like this, these questions we'd like to ask. In particular, some of these questions that trip up people in their journey to faith. Some of these questions that might even keep them from coming to faith. Pastor and author Lee Strobel actually commissioned a survey and asked people what one question they would like to ask God. And the top response is, why is there suffering in the world? It's okay to ask this. It's not like you're blaspheming when you ask God that question. You'll find a lot of complaining about God, and much of it directly to God, in the pages of the Bible. It's kind of amazing. Almost half of the Psalms, like the one I read, are Psalms of complaints, of calling on God. No other religion has its holy text so packed with complaints against its deity. Our God invites us to come and challenge. How long will you forget me, O God? Forever? How long will I be left to my own wits with this agony? Is that going to happen every day? Or here's another one, another Psalm 6. Have mercy on me, Lord, because I'm frail. Heal me, Lord, because my bones are shaking in terror. My whole body is completely terrified. But you, Lord, how long will this last? Come back to me, Lord. Deliver me. Save me for the sake of your faithful love. No one is going to praise you when they're dead. I love that one. God, you know, I can't praise you when I'm dead. Who gives thanks from the grave? I'm worn out from groaning. Every night I drench my bed with tears. I soak my couch all the way through. Wow. And like I said, half the Psalms have a tone like that. When Jesus was asked such questions, he never responded with a neat, simple answer to the problem of human suffering. And I'm really glad, because I'm always a little bit suspicious of people who have neat, pat answers to some of these really difficult questions. Anybody who talks too glibly about this kind of mystery. And frankly, you know, really, I can't give a tidy answer either. But I do know that there are some things we can understand about suffering. And one of the things I think we can understand is actually a negative. That I think is a misunderstanding that people approach it. Sometimes church leaders approach it, and I think they answer the question completely wrong. A couple of answers that are not helpful, and frankly I think are wrong, because I believe the Bible says something different. One of them is that God is the kind of creator who would just sort of wind up the watch of the world and let it run and leaves us completely to our own devices. I don't think that's supported in that. I don't think that's supported in our actual experience. There's the opposite belief, though, that God is a micromanager. That if anything happens, God is sovereign, right? So if anything happens, that must be what God wants to happen. It must be God's will if that happened. If anything bad happens, any suffering you or I are experiencing, well, that's part of God's plan, and we're limited, so we can't understand how good that is for us. Do you hear that? And we think, well, how can the loss of a child, how can the death of a loved one, how can a disease that we've received, how can that be good? But in this way of thinking, everything happens for a reason, so there must be a good reason. Maybe the suffering is happening because of God's judgment. God is punishing you for something you did badly. There are Christian leaders who have written papers about how the Asian tsunami that killed 250,000 were God's judgment for some reason. How 9/11 was God's judgment on America. And that's not biblical. And how they stretch things like that. So they think God is judging, God is punishing us for that. Or they may say, well, God is teaching us something, so that's why God caused this terrible thing to happen in your life, so that you could learn something. And while there might be on the edge of that some truth, at the core saying, God caused this to happen in order to teach you a lesson, it's not biblical. In fact, Jesus said no. Jesus argued against it when he was asked. So we try to offer comfort sometimes with statements. Someone loses a loved one and say, well, God must have wanted him, so God took him, which is not really helpful. I'd encourage you not to give that kind of encouragement, not the kind of, well, you know, everything happens in God's will. It's part of God's plan. That's not the kind of comfort we necessarily need. That's not what we need to give. Clearly, things happen in the Bible that are not God's will. So apparently, things happen that aren't God's will. Maybe that's true today. Maybe things happen in the world. Maybe it wasn't God's desire that the towers would fall, that the tsunami would flood all of those lands. Maybe it's not God's desire that COVID-19 is sweeping across our country and around the world. So, what can we take from some of this? I mean, part of it is that we can't understand all things, as Paul says. We see the truth partially, but so we might ask where it comes from, and we ask what God is doing in this. So there are a couple of key biblical truths that I think might be points of light that would help us to approach suffering in our world. And if we follow those lights, maybe they'll lead us in the right direction towards some conclusions that might give us some peace with the idea of suffering in our world. To begin with, the very first one is saying God is not the cause, not the creator of pain and suffering. Why didn't God create a world where suffering didn't exist? And the thought is, the answer is, God did. Genesis 1:31 says God saw all that he made and saw that it was good. But in that goodness, in God's love, human beings are created to be in God's image, to be those who make choices. And in fact, early on in the very first chapter of Genesis, it says that God has given human beings dominion, or in other words, control over the earth. And decisions that we make cause good things to happen and also cause bad things to happen. God doesn't micromanage. God's choice was to bless human beings with the will and the ability to make those choices without forcing them, without coercing them. And it all comes down to love, because God seeks relationship with each of us. A relationship of love is one that is not coerced. We cannot love if we're puppets or machines or, you know, forced to do what God wants. And so God has to leave an open space for us. So I think that helps when I think about the mystery of suffering and think that, to begin with, God did not create it. So it exists. God didn't make it. But here's another point, is that God does use all pain and suffering. God takes the pain and suffering in our lives and wrings something good out of it. God doesn't send the sufferings or cause our sorrows, but God doesn't waste anything. Even the pain in our lives, God uses it. Sometimes God uses it to draw people to Christ. C.S. Lewis once said, God whispers to us in our pleasures, God speaks to us in our conscience, but God shouts in our pain and uses it as a megaphone to rouse a deaf world. 2 Corinthians says, God sometimes uses sorrow in our lives to help us turn away from sin and seek eternal life. God uses pain in our lives to help sharpen our character, to build patience and perseverance and character. God uses suffering in our life to lovingly discipline and turn us towards things that might lead to a better future. God fulfills the promise of this passage that I read from Romans 28. That last one, that we know that passage, the end part. We know that in all things God works for the good for those who love him, who've been called according to his purpose. In other words, God is taking bad circumstances that befall us and causing good to emerge. But there's another promise, and that's that one day suffering will cease. The worst thing that has happened to you is never the last thing that has happened to you. And so God's promise is that there will be a day of restoration. So if we are waiting for God, you know, why hasn't God eradicated all evil and suffering if he could do that? And the thing is that God just hasn't done it yet. And the promise at the end of our scriptures in Revelation is that one day God will wipe away every tear. And so there is hope and expectation for the coming future. And not only is there hope and expectation of that, but our suffering today is going to be almost nothing compared to the glory that we see then. As the Apostle Paul says, for our light and momentary troubles. Now, this is the Apostle Paul who suffered beatings. He was stoned multiple times. He went through shipwrecks and imprisonments and hunger and thirst, rejection and homelessness, and far more pain than most of us will ever imagine enduring in our lives. And then he's the one who said, for our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. And in another place he says, I consider my present sufferings, they're not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. So Paul, who had that really extreme stuff happen to him, it wasn't that he's making light of it, but he is trying to compare it to the glory that he can see in our future. And so there's something that you say, as bad as this is, it will seem like nothing compared to the grace and the glory that we receive in the presence of God. So a lot of those are promises with that. And then that sort of leaves us with the sense of, well, what's it about? It's kind of about how I'm going to respond to suffering, to pain, to difficulty in my life. We can choose. Remember, God gave us free will and the ability to choose. We can choose to turn bitter, or we can choose to turn to God for hope. The big issue is how we respond to our circumstances. Bitterness and rejection of God might be pushing away the only thing that can make our sufferings bearable. The same suffering that causes a person to reject God, to turn bitter, angry, and sullen, might cause another person to turn to God, to become more gentle, more loving and tender, more willing to reach out to others in pain. Jesus says, these things I've spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you'll have trouble, but take courage. I have overcome the world. If we claim that, turn to Jesus and claim that, it gives us a way through our suffering. There's, I heard it quoted, someone shared this with me and said he didn't know where it came from, but it's about suffering. Here, let me read this. Suffering is not God's desire for us, but it occurs in the process of life. Suffering is not given to teach us something, but through it we may learn something. Suffering is not given to teach others something, but through it they may learn. Suffering is not given to punish us, but sometimes it's the consequence of our sin and our poor judgment. Suffering does not occur because our faith is weak, but through it our faith may be strengthened. God doesn't depend on human suffering to achieve his purposes. Sometimes, however, his purposes are achieved through human suffering. Suffering can either destroy us or it can add meaning to our lives. God's ultimate answer to suffering isn't an explanation, though. It's the incarnation. Suffering is a personal problem. It demands a personal response. And God isn't some distant, detached, disinterested deity. God enters into our world. God enters into our pain. Jesus is there sitting beside us in the lowest places of our lives. That's what one teacher said. We ask for questions and God doesn't give them to us. God gives us Jesus. Are you broken? Well, so is Jesus. Do you feel rejected? Do sorrows overwhelm you? Scripture, he was despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, from Isaiah. Did someone betray you? Jesus was sold out. Are your tenderest relationships broken? All of those describe Jesus. Every tear we shed becomes Jesus' tear. Corrie ten Boom, who wrote after she came out of a Nazi death camp where she lost her sister and much of her family. No matter how deep our darkness, God is deeper still. And she quotes Psalm 34, God is close to the brokenhearted and saves those who are crushed in spirit. If that describes you, you have a choice to turn bitter or to turn to God. To turn to God and find the kind of peace that Corrie ten Boom found. You can turn away from God and then all you have is suffering. And that's all you have is the suffering. Suffering without the knowledge that God is walking through this with me. Suffering without the faith that God is going to bring something good out of this suffering. Suffering without the knowledge that God is going to have the final word. That's why I want to encourage you to become a person of faith, to understand that the world around us and how God works in the world, and to be able to turn to God and to hold on tight. Not everything happens because God wants it to happen. But here's what God promises. Not that nothing bad will ever happen to us, but that God will walk through it with us. That the worst thing is never the last thing. Disaster, disease, death, it will never have the final word. There's always hope. God takes the pain and wrings from it good. God walks with us through it, and God promises it never has the final word. Let's pray. Our gracious God, we ask you to sit with us, to draw near to us in our pain, in our questioning about the sorrow that we encounter, that our loved ones encounter. We know that the grief and sorrow of loss and difficulty and suffering just really sometimes becomes a challenge to our loved ones. And it becomes a challenge to us, and we ask for your peace, your wisdom, and your grace as we face it. Let us be those who truly can bring comfort, rather than giving advice, rather than somehow philosophizing. Teach us how to love as you love, and always to look toward your hope. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Maritza and James. It's always a blessing to have that music that can sometimes reach into our souls and bring that peace ourselves as we reflect. We're going to take some time to pray and to pray prayers of intercession. There is in our bulletin for this week and that you've received online, some of you picked it up as you came here, somewhere after in the back half of it, there is a prayer list of prayer needs and concerns that we become aware of. We never feel that it is entirely up to date, because as soon as we get this published, there are some more needs that seem to come up, or we hear some news about it. As I mentioned earlier, that cancer has touched so many of our lives, and there are many of us who are still dealing with it. And we just heard that Alan has had a return of that, and so I ask you to lift that up in prayers. I'm going to give a pause at a couple of places in the prayer, and I invite you just to lift up some of the needs that you might have become aware of already this week. There are a few. I'm just going to list some names of families and friends who are struggling with some issues, like Lucy and Arden and Zechariah and Rachel and Henry and Shannon and Donna and Doug. Some illnesses that we know, and procedures and recovery and health issues with Tony and Karen, and with Mikey and Liz, Joan and Jim, who are recovering, Bill and Darlene and Eve and Bev and Dale and Mark and Ron and Sherry and Jim and Nick and Judy and Chris, and Norma, you're on there, continuing to recover, and there are names that we don't have, but you know a lot of folks in your own hearts, and let's lift them up as well. Let's pray. Gracious God, we give you thanks for the opportunity to pray, and we thank you, Lord, that you do touch our hearts and our minds, and you remind us of the blessings that we've received. We thank you that you bless us with one another, and it was that as we gather, we might strengthen each other. And so we want to lift up to you this morning thanksgiving for all of the blessings in our lives. As we think of these blessings, we say, Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. Lord, we want to pray for those who are needy this morning, and we think first of those who are grieving. There are all sorts of places that grief comes from. Sometimes it is from suffering. Often it's from a loss. And so we pray for those who have lost, especially those who have lost loved ones. And we want to take a moment and each in our own hearts think of someone or a couple of people who are grieving that we want to lift up this morning. For those who grieve, Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. We have a list, Lord, of those who need healing, and there are so many more. And some of those other names are also in our own hearts. And so we're going to take a moment and just think of those who need healing and need your healing touch today. So, Lord, for those who need healing. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. There are those who suffer. We've been talking about it already, and we can imagine there are so many so many ways that people suffer. And it's not just those that we know. It's those all around the world who suffer from so many sorrows. And it's personal to each of them. And so this morning, Lord, as we can think of some of our loved ones who are suffering, we lift them and we lift all of those, including those who we don't know, up to you. For all who suffer, Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. Lord, often you are the one who has brought, you've given leadership and responsibility to us, to your creatures. And there are some who make decisions that affect a great number of people. And we lift them up to you, those who are our leaders in the community and the world, who make decisions that change the lives, that shape the world for so many. For our leaders, Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. And Lord, you have brought into our world so many people who love and serve their neighbors. And we give you thanks. We are blessed by all those who serve, and we think of those especially who are serving in schools, who are serving as EMTs and firefighters and police officers, those who serve in our local communities that keep our lives moving along, those who are serving in our medical community. And with all of the stress that they have been under over the last couple of years, we pray for your blessing on them. But we give you thanks for those who have looked out for others. We lift up to you also today those who are serving their country in the armed forces and have answered a call and may be far away from home. We give you thanks for all who serve, and we pray for your blessing on them. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. And Lord, we pray for our church. Not just our church here, though we pray for your blessing and power to be real in us, but we pray for your church around the world. Wherever people are that are calling on your name, we pray that you will use them, that they might show grace and love and reflect you to the neighbors around them. So we pray for your church. Lord, in your love, hear this, our prayer. Thank you, God, for the grace that we have received. Thank you, Lord, that we can call you our Lord and we can see ourselves as your people. And so we pray that you will use us, witnesses and disciples. We pray this in Jesus' name as we pray the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's join in singing that great hymn, My Faith Looks Up to Thee. The words will be on the screen. I invite you to join us singing.
Thank you.
Our church to have such a supported and committed fellowship, and so we want to give thanks to all of those who have supported the ministry of our church through your tithes and your offerings. And what we would like to do is take just a moment. We don't pass the plate, but people have the opportunity when they're present to drop off to put an offering in a plate near the entrance. And those of you who are at home, you can by our electronic giving, you can connect with us, or you can mail a check or to the church. And so we are grateful so much. We are blessed by that kind of support. Thank you. Join us. Let's join together in a prayer of dedication for all of these gifts. Great God of abundance, thank you for the comfort and hope we have in Jesus. In gratitude, we offer you our hearts, our lives, and all that we have. May our gifts and offerings be an answer to your call to free the trapped, heal the broken, and share your good news with the poor and helpless. Bless these signs of our love for you, O God, as we proclaim your glory to all people. Amen. So just a few announcements before we finish up. Most of the things that I mentioned are announcements can be found in the bulletin. And so invite you to look through that. Over on the sidelines over here in the other room, it is Super Bowl Sunday today. And we are on our normal Super Bowl Sundays, we might like have a soup cook-off and invite people to gather for a soup luncheon and to make a collection so that we can help support some of our mission projects via that. What we are doing this year, since we aren't all eating together, is that we're collecting cans of soup. And so over on the side room, we have a football field set up on a table. And already we have way too many players on the field, apparently. But we are still going to allow during this week, we're going to go into overtime a little bit. And we're going to allow through this week, if you would like to find an opportunity to donate any more cans of soup. The soup that we're collecting is going to our local food pantry, Open Cupboard. And you will see that along the sidelines on our football field here, we have a lot of ramen noodles who are essentially the fans, I guess. Anyway, our church is specifically collecting ramen noodles for the backpack program of Open Cupboard. And so all of these we're blessed to be able to be a blessing to our local food pantry so that they might be a blessing to families that might be a little bit food insecure. And so, yes, there's a last chance, though today is Super Bowl Sunday. So today is the day we're celebrating it. We thank you for all of you who have helped with it. We'll find out just how much we've collected because nobody's wanted to count it yet. So that's one of the things. There are other things going on in the bulletin. Looking ahead, it is tomorrow. It's Valentine's Day. Happy Valentine's Day, in case you haven't gotten Valentine's for, for your significant others yet. But it is also UMW meeting day, and it's the particular day the UMW's call to prayer and self-denial. And so the meeting is at 1 o'clock here at the church tomorrow afternoon. Then invite you throughout this week to pay attention to some of the things that are going on. We're moving towards Lent. And once we get into Lent, Ash Wednesday is March 2nd. And we will be starting a series of studies, midweek studies, Wednesday evenings as we move into Lent. And so look for that coming up. Most of the other details, you can look at the things that are there in the bulletin. This week, just to let you know, I am going to be out of town for a few days in the middle of the week. And if there are emergency calls that are needed, Pastor Jeremy Diener of the New Richmond United Methodist Church is able to take those calls. His number is in the bulletin. So for a few days that we're going to be out of town, and that's going on. Is there anything else? Franny, you were looking at some conversation about our neighborhood construction. Is there a meeting scheduled yet, or... Okay. Thank you. Yep. Just for those of you online who missed some of that we are wanting to set up a date where the folks from our church can meet with someone from the village council to talk about our neighborhood, and particularly the old hospital building across the street from us, and about the possibility of having that torn down sooner rather than another 10 years later. But also some possible proposals that people have been hearing about what might go into that place. And so our church wants to be a part of it, And also when you get into village politics, just like when you get into national and international politics, sometimes it can get acrimonious. And maybe it helps to have a few of the people of God around who just are praying it up and are encouraging conversations with grace and goodwill. And so let's keep that in our prayers. I think those are just the things going on this week. Why don't we stand for the benediction here? Together, let's pray. Redeeming and reconciling God, let your dream of a world that includes all people in your family be our dream as well. We know that it is only by the Spirit of Christ in us that can make that happen. Empower us and give us a passion to love our neighbors and to grow to fullness in Christ. Amen. Let's sing "Make Me a Channel of Your Peace" as we close. Make me a channel of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me bring your love. Where there is injury, your pardon, Lord. And where there's doubt, true faith. Yeah.
only life. And when there's sadness ever joy, oh Master, grant that I may never see so much to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, be loved as to love with all my soul. Make me a channel of your peace. It is in pardoning that we are pardoned. It is that we if dying that we're born to eternal
in the name of the resurrected Christ, all God's people said, amen. God bless you this week, folks.